Hi, everyone, and welcome to another live edition of View from the Other Side. And today I want to talk about a topic that might sound weird, but it's what do dead people do? And I get a lot of people writing in the comments, you know, when I look at the videos, when I look at the feedback, where many of you have said to me, so what do our deceased loved ones do on the other side all day long? What do they do after we cross over? What are we going to do? Do we get bored? Do we play golf? Do we play chess? Do we get to have fun all day? What does it look like? Do we have a home? So I get questions like that. So today I want to clear up some of the confusion or the questions around that. So first of all, let me start by saying that when we cross over, you know, when I died, so for those of you who don't know my story, please go back to video one of this View from the Other Side, where I share a little bit about my story, where I died from end-stage cancer, I crossed over, and I was on the other side. So one of the first things I noticed is that when we cross over, we have no physical body. You'd think that's obvious, but the thing is that it doesn't really hit you until you're there what the implication is of not having a physical body. When you have no physical body, it means you have no biology. So what does that mean if you have no biology? Not only do you not have gender and race and all these things, you know, skin color and all of these things that are associated with your biology, you also cannot speak because you don't have any vocal cords. And so you communicate telepathically. You can sense everything that the people around you are feeling. So when I was in that realm, I could sense everything that my family here in the physical were feeling as they were around my physical body that was dying. I could sense what they were all feeling. And I wanted to communicate with them, but I could not speak. I wanted to tell them, I feel amazing, I feel fine, but we have no vocal cords. Also, because we have no biology, we have no eyes, we have no ears, but we have heightened awareness, like really acute awareness. So we're still aware of everything that's happening all around, but beyond. So when you're in the physical and you're just viewing through your eyes, all you can see is what your eyes are focused on. But when you have no physical body and you are just pure spirit, pure essence, you are aware of, it's like 360 degree peripheral vision. I could see above, below, around. It's like pure awareness. And the hearing was also, it's like telepathic. You're aware of every sound, even the softest sounds, even the loudest sounds. But loud sounds don't hurt your ears because you don't have ears or eardrums. You're aware of it. You're aware of every tone. You're aware of whispering that could be going on miles away. So it's a very different way of being, and it takes time to get used to that. So when our loved ones cross over, first of all, they have to get used to the fact that they have no physical body, and they kind of have to navigate their way around being this way. That's what it felt like for me. But it feels really cool, like all the pain was gone, everything was gone, the suffering was over, the fear was gone. And then I was surrounded by the essences or the souls of other people, other loved ones, or they could have been higher beings. And I recognized only some of them, not all of them. So the other question I get is not only what do we do, but do we connect with our loved ones when we cross over? Yes, absolutely. Whoever will be comforting for us to see when we cross over, those are the people that will be around us, including our pets, even our pets that will bring us comfort. The most important thing in that moment that you cross over, the most important thing that happens is that you get a very, very comforting feeling and vision of the other side. You feel loved. You feel totally encompassed and enveloped by love. So now, So now what do you do all day when you're over there? So because you have no physical body and no physical needs, you don't really need a house. But if it brings you comfort to see things like that, they appear for you. They manifest for you. So when people say, what does it look like on the other side? It literally looks like whatever you want it to look like. You can travel through space if that's what you want. You can travel to other planets if that's what you want. You can travel through the galaxies if that's what you want. Or you can see beautiful fields and trees and grass and meadows and live in a beautiful cottage or a house or have animals. Literally because you are manifesting out of thin air. You are pure soul and you're calling on all the other souls and they are there for you and you're manifesting. But what I sensed is that you don't need that for very long, because that desire to be surrounded by things that are familiar from this side, things like even the ability to, let's say somebody said, do we play golf on the other side? That desire to want to continue to play golf on the other side and think that, oh, now I have time to play golf or chess or read or catch up on all the things I couldn't do here. Those, if you have them at all, are very, very short-lived. They're just to get over the hump of having crossed over and getting used to being on the other side. You soon realize that you don't need all of that. In fact, the reason we come here is to do those things. It's to spend time finding our joy and eating. Oh, and so, and the other thing is that because we have no physical body and no biology, we don't need to eat food. So there's no food. People say, oh, can you eat as much chocolate as you want on the other side? You can. You absolutely can get that sensation. So you can literally manifest the sensations, but you don't need to actually have the physical chocolate there. You don't have the biology to even digest it. You have no gender because you don't reproduce when you're on that side. Reproduction is something that's a here thing, not a there thing. The other thing I want to say is that when we cross over, we are a pure spirit, pure soul, right? And many of us, all of us, have lived multiple lives. And so when you cross over, you eventually, even though in the beginning, you only identify with the life that you have just departed from. So let's say me, Anita, I identified with my family and my loved ones from this side. And the loved ones who I was surrounded by on that side, like my dad, my best friend Sony, were people I recognized from this side. But there were others who I didn't recognize, which I suspect were from other lives that I have lived, other than this one. Or maybe they were ascended people who've never lived physical lives, but were there looking out for me. But had I spent more time there, I would have started to identify with all the other lives that my soul had lived. So then what happens is that my soul is no longer just the soul of Anita. It is also the soul of all the other people I have been in other lives. And so I'm connecting with all the people as well that were connected to me from all those other lives. And what happens is, because we have no physical body and we have no boundaries per se, we communicate with each other by telepathy. But it's not even telepathy the way we know it here, because even here we think in terms of linear time and we string things together in sentences and we process it. Over there, it's literally instant. When somebody wants, when a soul wants you to know something, literally it's like their essence merges with your essence and you know it. You know the truth. You know what they want you to know right away. There's no hiding from each other. Everybody knows each other right away. You cannot pretend to be someone you're not. You literally are transparent. And every soul can know you literally just by being in your presence. They know you and they know what it is that you want them to know. That's what it felt like. And to that extent, we are all connected. So on the one hand, when you cross over, you become pure consciousness. Everybody is pure consciousness. So you all connect. You are all connected. You are all one. If you go back and watch one of my previous videos on the soul's journey, you will see that I talk about the mirror ball, where each of us is like one mirror. Each soul is like one mirror on a mirror ball, but we're all connected. So we are all part of one mirror ball, but yet each mirror still retains its individuality. However, it's not individuality the way we know it here. I don't retain the individuality of Anita. My mirror is not Anita. My mirror is every life that this soul that is currently Anita has ever lived. And I could have been a man in some lives, a woman in some lives. I could have been a mother to children, a daughter, a brother, a sister. So that mirror, my soul, when I go merge back with, when I leave this body and become my soul, that soul will identify with every life I have lived. I often talk about how your physical body, your life right now, is just the tip of the iceberg. Your soul is much huger than your physical body because your soul has lived multiple lives and has information and experiences from all these lives. And so your soul is much more knowledgeable than you give it credit to be. And it's much more knowledgeable than any knowledge you can attain here in this physical. So what does our soul do when we're not expressing in the physical? Our soul is continuing to evolve. It is continuing to support people here in the physical. It's continuing to help people here. It's continuing to elevate people here. But here, I want to say that every soul is at a different stage of its own evolution. Sometimes we wonder why there are people who commit evil over here. And we like to think that when somebody is evil, that when they cross over, that they will be punished or that they will go to hell for all of eternity. That's actually not the case. You have to think more in terms of reform as opposed to punishment. When we cross over, we realize, oh, wow, this is why I did what I did. I could have done it differently. That was terrible. However, having said that, there is no evil on the other side. All the acts that we label as evil can only be done here, not on the other side. Because when you're on the other side, everybody knows everybody else's motive. Nobody has an agenda. There's no competition. All the competitiveness, the greed, the things that drive people to do these things are all here. And I believe that every single one of us comes here with good intentions, but things go wrong. Either we get abused, We fall into, I don't know, weird influences or whatever. We become depressed. And so things happen here. But once we cross back over, we can see where we went wrong. And we try to evolve beyond it and fix it within our soul's journey. And we either try to evolve from the perspective of being there and assisting people here, or perhaps we might feel we need to evolve it by incarnating some more. So different souls are at different stages of evolution. So chances, there are many souls that have lived a lot more lives and are more experienced and are what we call more evolved. However, I usually refrain from using the word evolved because it's kind of it does carry some weight of judgment when we say, oh, that person's really evolved and that one's not really evolved, that person's not evolved. I try and refrain from using that terminology because I feel that I don't have the right to judge who's evolved and who's not. However, it really does feel like there are certain people who are more experienced souls who are here to uplift the planet. And there are certain souls who are still just feeling their way, stumbling, getting things wrong, and could be hurting other people on the way, along the way on their journey. So while you are here in this physical, yes, it is important from the physical realm to uplift yourself and align yourself and attune yourself with people who are more, who have more life experiences, and the people who actually operate on a higher frequency, who are what we call more evolved souls. It is probably better for you to do that. But at the same time, when you do that, when you uplift yourself, you are actually helping to uplift the entire planet. So this is something we continue to do even on the other side. We continue to evolve in our experience. We continue to try and evolve this world and the people on it and our loved ones from this life and other lives. We continue to try to help them and assist them. That's what we do. And for all I know, we could also be incarnating in different dimensions and different planets. We could be overseeing other dimensions and planets. So that is a definite possibility from that realm. The other thing also is that when our loved ones are trying to uplift us and help us, we still have the free will as to whether to allow them to help us or not. Their intention is to uplift us. They want to do that. That is what helps them to grow. In a way, we are helping them by letting them help us. It is also part of their evolution. But we have to be open to it. We really do have to allow them to work through us and to an extent also trust them. And the interesting thing is very often the ones who have hurt us the most are the ones who are the most determined to help us. But at the same time, there are also the souls that have much more life experiences that come and help to uplift us as a planet, as a race, as a culture. Because as a culture, I have to say that us here in this physical plane as a whole, we are pretty immature. We're still highly focused on competitiveness and ruthlessness and greed and power. We're still power hungry. We're still more interested in, as nations, we're more interested in spending our money on developing weapons to destroy people instead of spending our money to feed people. So we are a very, very, very immature race. And so I truly believe that the souls, the spirits on the other side are actually trying to help us, but we have to assist them. We have to allow them to help us. We really do. And how do we allow them to help us? We allow them to help us by knowing that they are there, that they are able to work through us, by trusting that, by opening up to them, and by not being overly skeptical. And you know, there's a lot of people out there who say, oh, this is woo-woo, this is crazy, this is... And what happens when we do that is we're dismissing an entire reality and we're limiting ourselves, again, just to that tip of the iceberg that I mentioned, that little... that 10% of who we really are. So the way to open up, to allow them to help us and uplift us and to be guided by them, that's the other thing. They're trying to guide us all the time. They're actually trying to guide us, not only for our own lives, but also to help us uplift the planet. And you can do that even by getting quiet, and you can do that by asking them even before you go to bed, say, oh, I would love for you to just show me in dreams, or show me as I fall asleep, or give me some guidance. You can actually do that and be open to signs and things like that. One of the things that I also believe is that we want to come here, when we come here, when we choose to come here, we are actually anxious to come here into this physical, because we want to be able to feel our bodies and we want to be able to express in this way. We want to be able to eat chocolate and fall in love and have relationships. We want to be able to, if your thing is playing golf or whatever it is, we come here to do those things. Those are not the things that we do on the other side. Those are the things we do here. What I believe we need to do is to realize that we're here not just to suffer, in fact, not to suffer. Suffering does happen inevitably. We do suffer from time to time, and it takes us to the next level. But that is not our true purpose. Our true purpose here is to experience the whole range of emotions, including joy, including fun, laughter, love, to really experience love. The one last thing that I really want to leave you with is that all the souls, all the spirits, all the beings on the other side, regardless of where they are on their evolution, and this is why I sometimes have trouble with the word, some are more evolved than others. It's because regardless of where they are in their evolution, they cannot harm you and they actually love you. They love you. They really do. They love us. Their only intention is to help. There are some that have more ability to help because they have more life experiences, and some that have less ability to help. But all of them love us, and their intention is to help and to uplift and to evolve themselves. And in order to evolve themselves, we have to allow them to help us. We have a tendency to think that if a soul is less evolved, that they are harmful, that they are negative, that they are evil, that the evil souls are less evolved. That happens here. The evil takes place here when people feel trapped or backed in a corner or have been abused or traumatized or depressed, whatever, as I've said so many times before. But on the other side, there is no evil. There is only love. But yes, there are some souls that are more capable of making bigger impacts and bigger changes than others. But every soul only intends love. Even if a soul has been your abuser in physical life, once they cross over, they can see the damage they've done. And they realize that they should have done it differently. And all they want to do is to help you heal from whatever it is they caused you. So, on that note, I would like to leave you with that thought that you are surrounded by loved ones and loving beings, and call on them. Call on them. They cannot interfere in your life unless you call on them. So, thank you so much. And if you enjoyed the content of this video, please click like, please click subscribe, please follow me, and I look forward to seeing you in the next episode of View from the Other Side. Thank you.